Welcome to the Diversity Pivot Podcast. I'm your host, Julie Kratz, and this season we will be unpacking real trends, hot topics in the workplace around allyship and inclusion. Our goal is that each week you leave with tangible tools, information, practical strategies that you can take back to allies with your organization. Let's dig in to this week's topic. Hey, listeners. I'm excited to be back with some hot topics that we've been covering over on our Forbes contributor column on allyship and thoughts that I'd love to share with this community as well. And one of the hot topics we've been exploring is around psychological safety. So this is something I'm currently getting certified in and learning much more deeply about this work. But for folks that the term might be new to, or the intersection certainly with diversity, equity, inclusion, and allyship work, we're just beginning to make these linkages. But just to step back and define the term psychological safety so that we're all on the same page here is it's really the ability to say or do hard things without the fear of retaliation at work. And Amy C. Edmondson out of Harvard has been studying it for decades. It's highly correlated with team performance. Google famously found in the early 2010s from a study they did on high-performing teams that psychological safety was the number one attribute that they found in common with high-performing teams. So if it's so important, why is it so void in the marketplace, in the workplace today? So I talked with folks at Wiley who just did some research on psychological safety. It was really interesting. In their interview, they said it's really about feeling valued. So take away all the fancy academic definitions. Like, do you feel valued at work? Do you feel like your opinion's valued? Do you feel like a differing, perspective is valued? Do your identities, can you fully bring those at work? And there's a stark difference between executives and other folks. So 89% of executives agree they can bring their unique skills, talents, and they feel valued on their team, but only 82% of their direct reports agree. So, a bit of a gap there. But then when you dig deeper into the behaviors that are associated with psychological safety, that's where you see the disconnect between what leaders think and what is real in the workplace. So the percentage differences are much lower, and things like only 42% of managers feel psychologically safe compared to 57% of executives, which, those numbers are relatively low in general, just less than half and a little over half. 40% of leaders agreed that if they made a mistake, it'd be held against them. So that's certainly not psychological safety. And then 53% of employees feel safe to take a risk, when 76% of executives do. So big difference there. And 68% of employees agreed that no one on their teams would deliberately undermine them. So, that's toxic. But one third doesn't agree with that, which is definitely a sign of a lack of psychological safety. So what do you do? A couple reads I recommend: The Five Dysfunctions of a Team. Oldie but goodie, Patrick Lencioni's work really builds off of vulnerability-based trust, really extending trust without the known reciprocation, which is very vulnerable, but very trust-building and psychological safety building on a team. And then the Psychological Safety Playbook, I highly recommend, really distills into specific things you can say, specific things you can do, which I think leaders today are really hungry for. Take these nebulous concepts and how do I do it with my team? But it is a mindset shift. So I would encourage leaders to really think about, do I want to hear dissenting opinions? Do I want to be challenged? Because that's the kind of environment that you need to create. And if you don't really have the mindset around that, no amount of behavior is going to convince your team that it's truly psychologically safe. So it really has to be done authentically. But if you want more productivity, lower turnover, less sick days, these are all highly associated with psychological safety. When people feel valued, they value their work. They care much more than just project to project, email to email. They care deeply about the purpose and working on a team. So a couple key things to keep in mind if you want to build more psychological safety. One is, again, get your mindset right. Two, really think about behaviors that you could demonstrate as a leader, as a team member. Anyone could demonstrate on the team because we're all mirroring and matching each other's behavior on teams. So how can you admit mistakes and, you know, apologize when you make a mistake? Really own your role and failures, and having failure learning opportunities. You know, I remember when I was in corporate, we had a big, you know, mistake with a client, and, you know, I wanted to really surface it and debrief it, but I was quickly met with resistance from our leadership team and almost like a shunning of like, ooh, we don't do that here. Which was really unfortunate because no one had the opportunity to learn from something I made a mistake about and I wanted to talk about because hiding it felt worse to me. So think about the experiences you've had. Think about ways that you could lean in to those vulnerabilities, whether it's mistakes, failures, weaknesses, saying, I don't know, I'm sorry. These are all highly correlated. And again, it has to be, the mindset has to be around it. It has to be genuine, it has to be authentic. This isn't just something you can say or do one time and check off the psychological safety bucket. It's really an extended relationship with our team over time. But when only, you know, 40% of folks feel psychological safety in the workplace, what a unique competitive advantage that you could build as a team. So again, encourage folks, dig in. Wiley has some amazing research. Amy C. Edmondson is very much a thought leader in this space. The Psychological Safety Playbook is a great resource to dig into more. And share your comments with us, other hot topics you'd like us to explore. We'll be digging into those week by week. Thanks, listener. Thank you for listening to the Diversity Pivot Podcast. My hope is that you walked away with a tangible tool, insight, or information that you can share with other allies on the journey. If you liked this week's episode, please leave us a review. Your feedback means a tremendous amount to us. We'll be back next week with another hot topic.